We are very fortunate today to be part of the AustCyber Cyber Week, and we're super grateful for their partnership on this event today. As you know, RSA Conference is committed to amplifying innovation. We want our community members to hear from companies that are novel, they're taking novel approaches to attack the complex problems our industry is facing. And to help us achieve that, we've been taking a tour around the globe, stopping in different cities to see what's happening there. Today, we're here in Australia, having a chance to look at some Australian startups to pitch their solutions and get questions answered by an illustrious panel. Before I turn this over to the panel for introductions, we will start this programming with just a short panel, kind of putting a level set on what is cloud security. And then we're gonna swap over to the two startups who will give their pitches, and then the panel will go ahead and ask questions. But before I even start with that, I just wanna take a moment to say how excited I am that all of our panelists are women. So this is a great moment in time. And I'm gonna make a small plug here for the Innovation Sandbox contest, which does have its submissions open. And I hope that by having these women in front of you, you can see yourself here and you too will go ahead and apply for it. But let's get back to what's happening in today's show. We're gonna first ask our panelists to introduce themselves, give a little bit of their background, and then answer the question, what is the biggest gaps in cloud security today? This is gonna start with our co-host for today's showcase, AustCyber CEO, Michelle Price. Michelle?
Well, good morning and good afternoon and good evening, everyone. Thank you so much, Cecilia. We absolutely love our partnership with RSA conferences, and we continue to have that relationship for many years now. This is an awesome event, and we are so, so proud to bring it to you as part of AustCyber's Cyber Week in Australia. We've got amazing cloud security, application security, infrastructure security, a whole range of different security offerings down here in Australia that provide agility and flexibility no matter what it is that you're looking for. So when it comes to cloud security, we are absolutely wanting to make sure that everyone in the RSA audience understands what Australia has to offer. Of course, cloud security is something that is critical to everyone today. And it's whether or not you're a micro business all the way up to the largest employers in the land, everyone needs to understand why cloud and cloud security is absolutely what you need to be focusing on today. And so to be able to give you innovative solutions today as part of this event, we're really, really excited to demonstrate the innovation that comes with cloud security.
Excellent. So I'm going to turn it over to our other panelists. So Michelle is the CEO of AustCyber. I'm going to let Fiona and Lesley go ahead and introduce themselves and go ahead and answer what are the biggest gaps in cloud security. And we'll start with Fiona. Or we can start with Lesley. I think that maybe Fiona has a problem with her audio or she's on mute.
I forgot we were all on mute, so thank you. Yeah, look, likewise, really delighted to join a panel of all women. It doesn't happen very often. And, you know, cyber is sort of one of those emerging areas that we really need to see more people coming in. You know, diversity is one of those critical components. So I am not a cyber specialist, but I am deeply committed to supporting innovators through breakthrough capabilities and taking those globally to market. I run a venture capital fund called Significant Capital Ventures, and we focus on bringing innovations out of university, research-led, IP-heavy innovations to the market and funding them at that earliest stage when they really are maybe just beyond ideation and looking for that global reach. In our portfolio, we've got one leading cyber platform called Fifth Domain. And over the path, we've funded previously a number of sort of platform-based, security platform bases. What we're really passionate about is funding commercialization of intellectual capital. And so for us, innovation is critical. Innovation that comes out of cyber network is particularly critical. It impacts every single startup that we work with. And to really embed a psyche around the importance of cyber at the earliest stage of those companies is imperative to us. So that's, I guess, part of the challenge that we're facing. Now you're on mute.
And you're right. And I was saying that that's actually a really great lead-in to Lesley, as you are, you know, ironically, this week in the U.S., we've had a lot of talk between the government and academia and private sector having a partnership and the power of partnership that's coming out of CISA. And so this is actually, this panel demonstrates that. So Lesley, can you share with us a little bit of your background and maybe some interest you have on cloud security?
Thank you very much, Cecilia, and thank you to AustCyber and all the RSA and all the other sponsors presenting AustCyber Week. It's really good that we're actually bringing this up again, because this is not going to, cyber's not going to go away. So a bit of my background, I've been in and out of policy space, academia, public sector and policy, etc., strategy and so on for most of my career. I was the CEO at the Bureau of Meteorology, so that was a very hard and fast introduction to all the issues around cyber. And I was most recently running something called the Cyber Institute at the Australian National University. Just going to the question about cloud security, one of the big issues I see is that it's not so much gaps, because the speed, what we're seeing is the speed and velocity of change. Inherently, as soon as you feel as though you're getting on top of things, you know, opportunities and challenges open up. We put in solutions, and that itself will then generate a whole range of challenges for users, developers, and the broader ecosystem for companies and organizations around cyber. And so, to me, one of the big challenges here is, yes, cloud security. Moving to the cloud gives you lots of opportunities. It gives you the flexibility and opportunity for change. That itself presents a real challenge to organizations, which may be more used to moving at a much slower pace. So those are the challenges I see.
I think you're dead on those challenges. And I think that, you know, taking a look just at what's happening in cloud security today, it's coming to the fore, and it's where everybody's talking about how to build this cloud security. Michelle, can you just share some thoughts around how important it is for security companies to provide a multi-cloud solution rather than just relying on one cloud service provider? What are the challenges or benefits of multi-cloud?
Yeah, thanks, Cecilia. I love this question, because we get to talk about the fact that we've moved beyond just the cloud. And so to be able to talk about the fact that there is multi-cloud and hybrid cloud, for audience members that aren't aware of those terms yet, that's okay. You know, multi-cloud is where you have different clouds of the same type. Hybrid cloud is where you have different cloud types within the same environment. So there's a bit of a distinction there, but what it gives you, multi-cloud in particular, what it gives you from a security point of view is the ability to be able to compartmentalize your infrastructure and really be able to hone in the types of security practices that you want to apply within those different areas of your cloud infrastructure. So multi-cloud, I think, from a benefits point of view, speaks loud and clear. And audience, that's available to you no matter what size of organization you are. I think there's a bit of a misnomer around how much it costs to do multi-cloud. It's actually incredibly cost efficient if you're working with the right kind of cloud infrastructure providers. The challenges, of course, though, is that you are increasing your footprint, and it does make it more challenging if you don't have the right skill sets available to you to be able to manage that infrastructure. But certainly the management of that infrastructure is a lot easier than the on-premises or on-prem as we know it to be, infrastructure that we used to run in the old days. And the old days were not that long ago. So it is a lot more efficient and effective to be working in a multi-cloud environment and be able to really hone in on your security practices around that. It's a really exciting development. And as much as it's been in place across other parts of the world, we're really just starting to get into this in Australia, and I'm really excited about it.
That is awesome. Now I'm going to go over to Fiona, and I just want to ask you, you know, Fiona, when you started this, you talked about how your venture capitalist group was actually really interested in commercialization. But as you know, it's very hard for startups to actually get their foot in the door. Oftentimes people are afraid to work with startups. What do you believe are the benefits in working with an early stage company in this space rather than the traditional giants?
Yeah, look, I think there's a number of benefits, and, you know, obviously I'm a little bit biased because we work with startups. That's our entire business. In terms of, I guess one of the benefits that I see most live is cultural. You know, the very nature of cyber is it's the frontier of innovation. So when you have large organisations that are structurally designed on old business models, it's actually very hard to innovate effectively. Whereas young companies that are coming out with, with sort of researchers out of uni or sort of first degree, second degree students or people who've been playing in cyberspace for, you know, since they were seven, that's the sort of place where you get extraordinary innovation. You get people who have been, you know, have truly grown up being defenders and attackers in a cyber environment for play. And so that's a very, very different mindset to the mindset that you get for people who have been corporatized. And so that's that nimbleness and that cultural agility is where I see one of the greatest benefits, because you get a responsiveness that just isn't available at a corporatized. And that's why I think we see this sort of, you know, the trend of, you know, hoovering up startups. Now, that's fantastic. But the problem is getting going in the first place. How do you get capital? How do you get started? And this is where there is a real problem, because it's all about scale up. It's all about how do you find people when the salaries that are being paid to young developers, whether they're cyber or just DevOps, you know, are phenomenal. So how do you then attract them into startups to bring their intellectual capital to the first point of innovation, when they're being paid these extraordinary salaries? That's one part, so accessing people, critical. The other is capital. There is a diminishing amount of capital going into early stage startups. And this is where I think there's a really unique opportunity for government to help step in and support that early ecosystem and get innovators up and going.
I agree with you. And it is an incredibly good time. If you are an entrepreneur, it's a great time to be in cybersecurity. If you are not, that this field is just growing in leaps and bounds, and to have somebody who has faith like Fiona here into these startups who can actually guide you along the way will only make your company grow stronger. I'm going to turn the last question over to Lesley. So Lesley, you've had a lot of experience at the university. Can you help us understand a little bit about how you might define cloud native security, and what are the benefits of using a vendor that uses a cloud first as more and more companies migrate to the cloud?
Okay.
Or hybrid model, if you're thinking.
Yeah. Okay, so I have to admit that both Michelle and Fiona have actually sort of stolen a lot of my thunder here. I mean, going into and starting with cloud as to start with has a lot of advantages, because the security architecture around cloud is quite different to just on-prem. I mean, there's issues there. You know, you're working with virtual machines. You're talking about serverless functions, etc. There's the opportunity to use containers and even containers as a service as well. The other thing is, because there's the rise of microservices in the cloud, etc., means that the code and the code structures themselves are much smaller. They're actually far more malleable and agile, etc. Now, that has a number of challenges that, you know, has been emerging over time, such as the problem with sprawl. We all, you know, we've all worked in organizations where you suddenly discover that, you know, a team has gone out and has started using their own instance of Slack or whatever it is, you know, Trello, Slack, all those, you know, even enterprise tools. In the developer space, they may well say, you know, the opportunities for them to just swipe their credit card and build those is leading to a whole range, you know, issues around sprawl. And the question is, how do you actually build a secure environment? So you have to get smarter about what's out there, how you actually structure it, et cetera. So that's the sort of thing that a vendor who starts in the cloud is better able, or is more likely to be able to bring that to you and structure that, help structure that for you. And Fiona's point about startup is absolutely on point, particularly, as I was saying before, with the speed of change that we're seeing in the industry. Just on hybrid cloud, we are going to see continuing instances of hybrid cloud for some very good reasons. And one of the reasons I will never say you must go to cloud only, or you must be either private or public cloud, or you must do on-prem, is because businesses, IT systems for businesses is highly contextual. They do need to recognize the business landscape of the organization they're working in. And so there are very good reasons why hybrid cloud will be in place, including just the legacy infrastructure and legacy investment of organizations mean that from an economic point of view, you're going to have that duality. Secondly, there may be regulatory requirements for things like data sovereignty and so on, which will actually promote both instances of private cloud, but also on-prem requirements. Last, there are also specialized areas such as, for example, I used to run sort of the supercomputer at the Bureau of Meteorology. Latency and access to the data in low latency environments would be really important when you're actually operating at that high level. And so, yes, having on-prem and having those specific infrastructure and pipes and all those sort of things is going to be important. And so we're going to see that a diversity of models throughout the industry was quite significant.